This is one of those days where we feel a lot of happiness and almost a little sadness as we say goodbye to our dear friend Despero today. Okay? So, but what incredible journey we as a school with Mr. Despero have been on the last few weeks. That has been tremendously awesome. And I know we thank them at the beginning, but I think it's important that we thank all our teachers and all the staff for all the work that they've done. Don't you think?
Yeah.
Let's give them a round of applause. Say thank you. And friends, we also had a lot of community partners, a lot of businesses and people out in the community that helped to make all of this happen as well. So I want to give them a shout out. So a shout out to the Fulton County Rotary Club, the Optimist Club, Women of the Moose, the Women's Giving Circle, Rochester Lions Club, Arnold and Laura Snipes, TCU funded our spaghetti dinner, and CMA, the Colbert Military Academy, with their fencing presentation. And a shout out to RTC there for videoing and recording all of our videos. So a round of applause and thank you. Okay, now, before we read our last pages together, we're gonna do a couple of things. First, I'm gonna invite Ms. Johnson up. Oh, sorry, Mrs. McCarter has come up. Well done, Ms. Johnson. Now, Mrs. McCarter's gonna come up because remember that you were all selling spaghetti dinner tickets? Remember that? Okay. Now, Mrs. McCarter has our top sellers here.
Okay, our top sellers, we had two, and we have Eli Somsel for Mrs. Zion's class.
On, including all of you helping with those spaghetti dinner tickets, and reading the book with us, answering all those questions and talking about it in class. We all came together to make this one huge project happen. That's pretty awesome, isn't it? Give me a yes, Mr. Lee.
Yes, Mr. Lee.
So I'm just so proud of everybody. It's been a tremendous pleasure, okay? But next, we have a special guest here. Okay. Does anybody know who the superintendent is? What does the superintendent do? Absolutely. Okay. And that person's called, so Mrs. Vance, come on up, Mrs. Vance. Mrs. Vance is our superintendent. She's in charge of all the schools in Rochester.
What?
Yep. She's like the principal of all the schools. Let's give her a round of applause. That's a lot of work. That's a lot of work. Okay? So, Mrs. Vance is gonna make a couple of announcements, and then we're so lucky she's gonna read the last pages with us, okay? So let's listen to Mrs. Vance, okay?
Thank you. One of the best parts of my job is to be able to honor those within the district that work really, really hard. And the students may not be aware, but I believe that all of the staff is aware, that we have a very special award that we present to employees who go above and beyond in their everyday duties. And that is called a Zebra Challenge coin. And I have several of those coins in my hand right now, and I want to make sure that you understand the importance of this. When I first walked into the building, Mr. Bernacki invited me in to see all of the decorations. And I think he will share with you that after I walked through the hallways the first time, I asked to go through a second time. You guys did an amazing job. There is so much that goes into this, and I'm so proud of all of you for instilling in our students not just the ability to read, but to make reading fun. That is something that not everybody is able to do, and I see it day in and day out over here. So I want to recognize those employees who went above and beyond to make this program a reality for all of our students and to instill in them the joy of reading. So if Ms. Coulter, Ms. Brooks, Ms. Johnson, Ms. McCarter, and Ms. Overmeyer will come forward, I would like to present to you a Zebra Challenge coin for going above and beyond throughout this program. Within the district that make this a reality. Did everybody have a good time last night?
Yeah.
And was there a special table full of all kinds of goodies and treats for you to eat?
Yeah.
That would not have been possible without Mr. Weon. So I would ask him to come forward as well and receive a coin for his. Chapter 51. What is that smell? Ooh, screamed Roscuro. He turned to look at where his tail had been, and as he did, Despero drew his needle and placed the sharp tip of it right where the rat's heart should be. "Don't move," said Despero. "I will kill you." "Ha ha," Botticelli laughed from the sidelines. "Exactly." He slapped his tail on the floor in approval. "Absolutely delightful. A mouse is going to kill a rat. Oh, all of this is much better than I anticipated. I love it when mice come to the dungeon." "Let me see," said the other rats, pushing and shoving. "Stand back," Botticello told them, still laughing. "Let the mouse do his work." Despero held the trembling needle against Ruggiero's heart. The mouse knew that as a knight, it was his duty to protect the princess. But would killing the rat really make the darkness go away? Despero bowed his head ever so slightly, and as he did so, his whiskers brushed against the rat's nose. Ruggiero sniffed. "What is that smell?" he asked. "Mousy blood," shouted one rat. "Blood and bone," shouted another. "You're smelling tears," said Botticelli. "Tears and thwarted love." "Exactly," said Ruggiero. "And yet, there's something else." He sniffed again, and the smell of soup crashed through his soul like a great wave, bringing with it the memory of light, the chandelier, the music, the laughter, everything, all the things that were not, would never, could never be available to him as a rat. "Soup," moaned Ruggiero, and he began to cry. "Boo," shouted Botticelli. "Hissed the other rats. "Kill me," said Ruggiero. He fell down before Despero. "It will never work. All I wanted was some light. That is why I brought the princess here. Really, just for some beauty, some light of my own." "Please," shouted Botticelli, "do kill him. He's a miserable excuse for a rat." "No, Despero," said the princess, "don't kill him." Despero lowered his needle. He turned and looked at the peas. "Boo," shouted Botticelli again, "kill him, kill him. All this goodness is making me sick. I've lost my appetite." "Boor," shouted Midge, waving her knife, "I'll kill him." "No, wait," said the princess. "Ruggiero," she said to the rat. "What?" he said. Tears were falling out of his eyes and creeping down his whiskers and dripping onto the dungeon floor. And then the princess took a deep breath and put a hand on her heart. I think, reader, that she was feeling the same thing that Despero had felt when he was faced with his father, begging him for forgiveness. That is, P was aware suddenly of how fragile her heart was, how much darkness was inside it, fighting always with the light. She did not like the rat. She would never like the rat, but she knew what she must do to save her own heart. And so, here are the words that the princess spoke to her enemy. She said, "Ruggiero, would you like some soup?" The rat sniffed. "Don't torment me," he said. "I promise you," said the princess, "that if you lead us out of here, I will get cook to make some soup, and you can eat it in the banquet hall." "Speaking of eating," shouted one of the rats, "give us the mousie." "Yeah," shouted another, "hand over the mouse." "Who would want him now?" said Botticelli. "The flavor of him will be ruined. All that forgiveness and goodness, I, for one, am leaving." "Soup in the banquet hall?" Ruggiero asked the princess. "Yes," said the pea. "Really?" "Truly, I promise." "Gore," shouted Mig. "Soup is illegal." "But soup is good," said Despero. "Yes," said the pea, "isn't it?" The princess bent down before the mouse. "You are my knight," she said to him, "with a shining needle, and I am so glad that you found me. Let's go upstairs. Let's eat some soup." And reader, begin. Chapter 52, Happily Ever After. But the question you wanted answered, I know, is did they live happily ever after? Yes and no. What of Roscuro? Did he live happily ever after? Well, the Princess P gave him free access to the upstairs of the castle, and he was allowed to go back and forth from the darkness of the dungeon to the light of the upstairs. But alas, he never really belonged in either place. The sad fate, I am afraid, of those whose hearts break and then mend in crooked ways. But the rat, in seeking forgiveness, did manage to shed some small light, some happiness into another life. How? Roscuro, reader, told the princess about the prisoner who had once owned a red tablecloth, and the princess saw to it that the prisoner was released. And Roscuro led the man up out of the dungeon and to his daughter. Midri Sal, Midge as you might have guessed, did not get to be a princess. But her father, to atone for what he had done, treated her like one for the rest of his days. And what of Despero? Did he live happily ever after? Well, he did not marry the princess, if that is what you mean by happily ever after. Even in a world as strange as this one, a mouse and a princess cannot marry. But reader, they can be friends. And they were. Together they had many adventures. Those adventures, however, are another story. And this story, I'm afraid, must now draw to a close. But before you leave, reader, imagine this. Imagine an adoring king and a glowing princess, a serving girl with a crown on her head and a rat with a spoon on his, all gathered around a table in a banquet hall. In the middle of the table, there is a great kettle of soup. Sitting in the place of honor, right next to the princess, is a very small mouse with big ears. And peeking out from behind a dusty velvet curtain, looking in amazement at the scene before them, are four other mice. "Mon Dieu, look, look," says Antoinette. "He lives, he lives. And he seems such the happy mouse." "Forgiven," whispers Lester. "Cripes," said Furlow. "Unbelievable." "Just so," says the Threadmaster, Hovis smiling, "just so." And reader, it is just so, isn't it? The end. There's one more thought in the book. If you flip back just another page or two, there's a coda that I've been asked to read. So the coda is an afterthought, something to pull the entire book together. So it's just a couple pages back. I'll go ahead and read that now. If you haven't found it, you can just listen quietly. The coda. Do you remember when Despero in the dungeon cupped in Gregory, the jailer's hand, whispering a story in the old man's ear? "I would like it very much if you thought of me as a mouse telling you a story. This story, with the whole of my heart, whispering it in your ear in order to save myself from the darkness and to save you from the darkness too. Stories are light," Gregory the jailer told Despero. Reader, I hope you have found some light here.
you, Mrs. Vance. How about a round of applause for Mrs. Vance here? Okay, friends. And now Mrs. Brooks has put together a special video for us to watch as our final goodbye to the tale of Desperate. Thank you.
reading.
Do you like reading books with other people?
Yeah.
Why? Why does that make reading better?
Because I liked the armor and the other one so good.
Yes, on the count of three, let's all say, goodbye, Despero.
Goodbye.
Well, all right, let's go. One, two, three. All right, thank you everybody for making this so magical, and that concludes this year's One School, One Book. Thank you, teachers.